Good afternoon, students. Welcome to the live lecture of Real Analysis 1. In the last lecture, we have seen the important concept of definition of primitive. Primitive is actually whenever we have a function capital F dash is equal to small f, then this capital F is called as primitive of here. And by first fundamental theorem of calculus, we can say the sufficient condition for the function to admit the primitive is continuity, right? These are some of the examples we have discussed, what is how the primitive is going to be calculated. But condition of continuity is sufficient but not necessary for the existence of primitive. As well as we have seen the second fundamental theorem of calculus, where the theorem says that whenever we have a small f function to be bounded and integrable, and there exists a function capital F is equal to, that is the primitive of this function exists, then our aim is to show that integration a to b small f dx is capital F b minus capital F of a. Many times in 12th standard, we have used this result in order to find out the integration, right? Now, in this today's session, we have proved it, right? To prove this, initially, we have written function capital F dash is equal to F integrable. So, we have written the Riemann definition of integrability, definition number 2, I can say. And we have written this to be statement number 1. Then, as of we were going to use Lagrange's mean value theorem for this. The Lagrange's mean value theorem says that if the function satisfies continuity on closed interval, derivability on open interval, then there exists a point having a special property C with this condition. F dash of C is FB minus FA upon B minus A. We have seen in detail how this C is going to exist. Later, the points Pi in the ith interval, we will going to select as per the Lagrange's mean value theorem. For this, we have written capital F is continuous on ith subinterval. Similarly, it is differentiable on the ith subinterval as well. Then by Lagrange's mean value theorem, the point Pi we have selected as of C. C in Lagrange's mean value theorem. No? Later, just by doing some calculations, we have proved the required result. Therefore, for the in general, instead of this, I can write like this. No, integration F dash is FB minus FA. But this equation holds if and only the function, that is the integrand, F dash is bounded and integrable. Therefore, it was asked us to prove with an example that this statement is not always valid. And to give an example, what we have done, we have found examples of the function whose F dash is not bounded. Correct, no? If F dash is not bounded, then it is not integrable. If it is not bounded, not integrable, we cannot use this statement, right? Now we cannot use this statement, or rather this statement is not valid. Later we have seen the mean value theorem of the integral calculus. Well, that is the first mean value theorem, one can say. What the first mean value theorem says? Whenever a function is continuous, see, continuous implies it is bounded as well as integrable. Therefore, whenever a function is continuous, then there exists a point zeta in the neighborhood a to b such that this statement holds. Integration a to b of dx is equals to f zeta times b minus a. Right now? Then, here we have seen with the help of our sketches that how that f zeta times beta minus b minus a works out. Right? Therefore, to prove this, actually here this zeta is your mean value. Right now? Mean doesn't mean it's an average. Mean doesn't mean it's an average. What it means actually? It means it's a point in the given domain having some special property. Now, what is the special property carried out by this zeta? That integration value is f of zeta times b minus a, which is the special property, right? Now, geometrically also we have seen f zeta into b minus is actually the area of the rectangle with length f of zeta, breadth b minus a, or height and width you can say. With the help of this example of f of x equal to x, we have verified also, no? F of x equals to x is the area with this, under this region, right? And f zeta into b minus a is the area shaded with this orange color. Therefore, if I just take out this triangle and if I place it here, it will give you the actual area. Correct? No? Therefore, this theorem is giving you the point zeta with a special property, But integration value is f of zeta times b minus a. Now to prove this, as the function is given to be continuous, it is bounded and integrable, we have written, where small m and capital M be the infima suprema, so that your any arbitrary function value lies between the two. Then integrating, we get that integration value lies between small m times b minus a to capital M times b minus a. That is, integration is some multiple of b minus a, and that we have written mu times b minus a, where as the function is continuous, this mu is E of image of some point knowing this continuity. Right now, for mu one can write as f of theta. This is what the proof of first mean value theorem we have seen in the last lecture. Now let us try to solve some examples calculating the mean value of the function, given value, given function. For here the first example is asked us to find out the mean value of function f of x equals to x square. F of x equals to x square in the interval say 0 to 1. In the interval say 0 to 1. Okay, what is the statement of mean value theorem? This is f of zeta times b minus a. And what is our aim? To find zeta, right now? Our aim is to find zeta for this example. Therefore, here I am going to find out the value of integration first. What is the value of integration? Integration a to b of dx? Is it integration 0 to 1 x square dx? Right now? Now, we have solved it earlier by using the Darboux definition of integrability and Riemann sum definition also. Okay? Without repeating this by either one of the definitions, we will solve with the theoretical formula. Right now? But in exam, you are not expected to solve by this. So to solve either by Riemann or Darboux definition. So what is the value? 1 by 3 is taken out. 1 minus 0 we have substituted. Therefore, the value of integration is 1 by 3. Now, the value of integration is known to us and we are expecting the value to find for zeta. Right? Then, what can I write? We wanted to write this 1 by 3 as 1 by that some value into b minus a. Right? Now, therefore, can I write this 1 by 3 as 1 minus 0 as it is this step? Because this is b minus a, no? We will compare this with this standard right-hand side. Therefore, this, what can I say about f of zeta?
1 by 3.
Yes, it is 1 by 3. And what is your function? X square, no? Therefore, what is the value of f of zeta? Is it zeta square? Correct, no? Therefore, what is the value of zeta? Plus minus 1 upon root 3. But whether minus 1 upon root 3 will come in this interval? 0 to 1. No. Therefore, which value we were adopting? 1 upon root 3. Minus 1 upon root 3 will not belong to closed interval 0 to 1. Therefore, we were not selecting this value. Therefore, what is the mean value of your given function? 1 upon root 3. Is it okay? Understood how to calculate mean value? Okay. Then I am giving you some examples to solve to find out the mean value of the given function. Say f of x is 1 plus x square in the interval say minus 1 to 2. What you have to do? You have to solve the integration by Riemann sum. Then equate it to f of zeta into b minus a and go for finding the value of zeta, right? Then I can again give you the value f of x equal to the 3x plus 1 in the interval 0 to 5. Okay? I think you can solve the integrations of these two functions by either by Darboux sum or Riemann sum. Which will be convenient to use among the two? Yes? We have two options. Either you can use Darboux sum method or Riemann sum method. Which you feel convenient to use? Kunti method sopi hai? Yes, Riemann sum will be simpler. Therefore, I suggest you to use the Riemann sum method to calculate the integration value once you calculate this integration value, try to write it as f zeta into b minus a, and then you can find out the value accordingly. I think one example is sufficient to understand. Correct, na? Now here I am going to write one remark. As this statement, if we observe, condition of continuity is given. Right now, function if continuous, then only this mean value exists. Means, can I say condition of continuity is necessary for the existence of mean value? Okay, and we are going to put this as a remark. In previous theorem, the condition of continuity is necessary. Necessary for the function to assume its mean value. Now we may check why it is necessary. We will take one example which is not continuous. Okay, and we will check whether its mean value exists or not, because as the condition is necessary, right? No. We will check one example where the function is not continuous. Example number 4 I can write. Okay. Say I am going to define the function f of x as a very simple function. I will define 3 between 1, 2, 4, say. Or even 4, I will write. And say this is 5 from 4 to 5. Can anyone tell me the nature of the function, whether it's continuous or not?
Yes, ma'am. Continuous.
Continuous? Let us draw this.
No, ma'am. No, ma'am.
At which point it is not continuous?
4.
Yes. Whenever we have an interval, disjoint intervals, at which point you are interested to check the continuity? At this break point you have to check only, right? Let us try to plot it. Okay. Between the region 1 to 4. 1 to, not exactly 4, up to 4. What's the function value? 3. What is your nature? Is it like this? A point just before 4. Right? Then what is the value from 4 to 5? Including 4, including 5. The value is 5, no? Function value. This is the graph, no? Now look at the graph and tell me whether it is continuous.
No,
no, it is not continuous. At which point? At this point 4, it is not continuous. Now what we will do? We will try to find out the integration of this and we will check whether its mean value exists or not. How can I find out the integration? Integration 1 to 5 e of dx. Now as the integration is divided, as the interval is divided into two parts, to find the integration, we will divide this in over the two regions, same two regions. That is 1 to 4 f dx plus 4 to 5 f dx. Is it okay? Between 1 to 4, what is your function value? It's 3. What's the value between 4 to 5? It's 5.
5.
And what is the integration of a constant?
X.
No, with this formula. A into b minus. Now, this formula I am going to use. If what is the value? 3 into 4 minus 1 plus 5 into 5 minus 4. Correct, no?
Yes, ma'am.
B minus I am writing. 4 minus 1, 5 minus 1. How much is the value? This is 3 into 3 plus 5 into 1, 9 plus 4 it is. 5 minus 4, right. 14, no? Now what we will do, we will try to write this as f of zeta into b minus a. What is your a being? 1 to 5, no? Therefore, what I am going to write, I am going to write this number 14 this v minus a. We wanted to write is of the form of f of zeta into b minus a. B minus a I have written. Then what should be a scalar here? 5 minus 1 is 4. Correct now? Therefore, we were multiplying by 4. So therefore, shall I divide by 4? Multiplying and dividing by 4. Correct now?
Yes, ma'am.
14 by 4 is 7 by 2 into 5 minus 1. Then what is your value of f of zeta you are getting?
7 by 2.
7 by 2. But whether f of zeta is equals to 7 by 2 holds? Whether any function value takes a value 7 by 2? Whether function takes a value 7 by 2? It takes 1's 3 for 1 to 4. It takes 5 for 4 to 5. Therefore, this f of zeta is not going to take any function. Okay? I can write here the function cannot take a value. Function cannot take a value 7 by 2. That is f of zeta is not equal to 7 by 2. Therefore, whether zeta exists? Yes, zeta do not exist in this case. Correct, no? Therefore, the function which is not continuous is not having any mean value. Function which is not continuous is not having any mean value. Is it okay to everyone? Understood?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now we will go for the next part, say generalized first mean value theorem. Whatever the first mean value theorem we have written, no, we were going to generalize it for the product of two functions. Okay, let me write the statement. Generalized first mean value theorem. First mean value theorem we have seen only for one function, no? But in the generalized case, we were going to write it for the product. Let me write the statement. If f and g are integrable on closed interval a to b and g keeps same sign over closed interval a to b, then prove that there exists a number mu lying between the bounds of f. Bounds of f means between suprema and infima, right now? Bounds of f such that integration a to b f dot g dx is mu times integration a to b g dx. Let's understand the statement. Both the functions are given integrable. G keeps the same sign. G keeps same sign means either it is non-negative or non-positive. Means it will not take both values positive negative simultaneously. Right? Keeps the same sign. Means either this g is on or above x-axis or on or below x-axis. Correct? The meaning of g keeps the same sign is either g is non-negative or g is non-positive for all x in the given interval a, b. Is that okay? Samajhte ka, g keeps same sign means ka hai? It will take same value, positive, negative as interchange honar nahi, fluctuations honar nahi. Okay? Then our aim is to find out the existence. Now, what is the mean value here? This is your mean value, no? Again, this mean value is lying between small m to capital M, infima and suprema. Okay, such that this happens. What this happens? Integration of a product f dot g is mu times integration of g. That is, if you know the value of integration of g, you can write this integration product is multiple of integration of g. Are you getting me? Integration of g is some multiple of integration g. This we wanted to show. Okay. Now as we were familiar with the first mean value theorem that we have proved, right? Now here we will start with g keeps the same sign. That is, we will take g non-negative. As g keeps the same sign over closed interval a to b, let g be non-negative. One can take non-positive also, no doubt. We'll first show for non-negative over closed interval a to b. We will mention the bounds also. If small m and capital M are bounds of F, okay, then we have, may I say the function value lies between? What? Capital M to small m? कशामध्ये येते फंक्शन व्हॅल्यू?
स्मॉल एम टू कॅपिटल.
दिस इट इज स्मॉल एम टू कॅपिटल एम. ओके. नाव एज ऑफ इन द प्रीवियस थिअरम व्हॉट वी हॅव गिव्हन, हाऊ वी हॅव गिव्हन द प्रूफ, डू यू रिमेंबर? फंक्शन व्हॅल्यू वी हॅव रिटन अँड देन वी हॅव टेकन द इंटिग्रेशन. ओके. देन इंटिग्रेशन small m is m times b minus a, integration capital M is capital M times b minus a, and then we have written this is mu times b minus a. Okay, same process we are going to follow, but we want a product, integrand as a product of two functions. No, integration f g we were calculating, therefore we will first multiply by g and we will do the same process. Okay, therefore here can I write multiply by g of x, what we get? And now, as we were considering g of x is non-negative, whether there is any effect on the given inequality? No. If it is non-positive, then the inequality gets reversed. Therefore, here I will write as it is. M g of x less than or equals to now we will do the integration. Integrating between a to b, we have okay, let us take an integration. Now, as this small m and capital M are constants, can we take it outside the integration?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, look at this inequality very carefully. What the inequality says? Integration of this product E of n to g lies between M times integration g to capital M times integration g. So let me make use of the same point as we have used for the first mean value theorem. If your integration value lies between small m times b minus a to capital M times b minus a, then how we have written integration? It is some multiple of b minus a, right? No, because using the same methodology, same pattern, can I say here the integration of this middle lies between some multiple of integration g, right? No. Therefore, here I'll write, let mu be a number lying between small m and capital M. Okay, then NRI integration, this product of हेलो, ऑडिबल? ओके, ड्यू टू पुअर इंटरनेट कनेक्शन देयर वाज अ ट्रबल. लेट मी जस्ट शेयर द स्क्रीन अगेन. आर द स्क्रीन विजिबल?
नो मैम.
Now it is visible. You can check.
Yes, ma'am.
Is the screen clearly visible or not? Is the screen?
No, ma'am.
Only things now.
हमारा फोटो डिस्प्ले का इंटरनेट कनेक्शन से प्रॉब्लम है. एक मिनट वेट करें.
Yeah, I am.